Siran, the legal of the chief is bachelor's and master's and degrees in architecture and statistics from Cambridge University and postgraduate diploma in archaeology from University of London. His doctoral study carried out at Harvard University examines Sri Lanka's prehistory from an archaeological perspective. Joining Sri Lanka's Department of Archaeology in 1968, as Assistant Commissioner, he retired from the active public service in 2002 as the Director General of Archaeology after serving 34 long years. A pioneer in research-oriented excavations in Sri Lanka, Dr. Deraniyagala has directed a number of projects dealing from proto and prehistory, early and middle historic, as well as Mesolithic and middle Paleolithic ages in Sri Lanka, and has to his credit over 50 research publications. He is a fellow of the American Anthropological Society and a permanent member of the Council of International Union of Pre and Proto History. He is a member of ICOMOS Sri Lanka and a fellow of the Council of Archaeologists and its past president. In recognition of his yeoman service rendered in the discipline of archaeology, he was awarded Doctor of Science and D.Litt from Universities of Sabarmati and Peradeniya, respectively. Dr. Deraniyagala continues his academic research pursuits while working as a senior consultant to the Department of Archaeology and the Central Cultural Fund. Thank you very much, Dr. Deraniyagala.
Technology was used to subdue the environment. Why subdue the environment? To survive. Otherwise, we would took care of the universal environment. And not the environment, there were other animal forms, living forms, which were competing with us, such as the age of the dinosaurs, for example. And we had to fight back. And one way before that was using technology. And I add, in that link today, we are using technology to fight animals. What are these animals? The microbes. Okay, in the effort to prevent the microbes now, not just climate change. What people don't realize that they are just losing it. My direct neighbors, that many people think these bugs are adapting to different antibiotics or
chemical
infection. And every, it any possible thing, you may have some greater infection, which is barely curable. You want to take vast over your drugs to be able to get rid of it. Now, how long is this thing going to last? Especially when it comes to viruses which don't react to antibiotics. My question really is that long before we destroy each other with atom bombs, with our own technology, those bugs are doing, but we have that slide. When and bugs are killed, some will survive, and evolution will start with a few strain of winners. That's how evolution works. All this is just the background canvas to put us, frail human beings, in perspective. That's a study. Don't see the evolutionary landscape. And it's 3 billion years of life, and where are we? Now, the first humans are known to have separated from our ancestors, the ape men, or in fact, the terms are called hominoids, around 6 billion years ago. Evidence comes from Africa. Now, as to why it comes from Africa, it's a moot point. The evidence comes from Africa because the preservation there is good. We get volcanic ashes sealing these deposits, making that preservation far better than elsewhere in the world. We do know that much earlier on, that the ancestors of the 6 million old hominoids were living in the Himalayan foothills. Sediments for the Siran deposits have produced ape-like forms, which are about 15 million years old, called Brahmacetus, Rivacetus, and so on, who have generally been assigned to the apes, but this is a new point. But the beginnings would have been much more widespread than is assumed. Anyhow, on test evidence, we separated from the apes around 6 million years ago. And the discoveries are still being made in Africa. They come in tiny little bits and fragments, largely because the preservation of human remains, human bones, is very, very sparse. Our bones are very brittle and prone to acidic action and don't survive unlike certain other heavier carnivores and so on. And in Africa, they evolved from 6 million years, evolving means keeping in mind what I made at the beginning. Evolving means fighting the environment, fighting your dog. The other animals compete for you for food and winning. You lose your loss and you are that's in the way line. So the present evidence is that around 3 million years ago, humans, real humans, were around, possibly several strains of several types of humans. And they were in different ecological niches in the African environment. Some were probably in rainforests, others in savannas and so on. But preferential in savannas, grasslands with solitary trees as in East Africa. Now, this human family tree is being constructed by paleoanthropologists. Now, I'm an archaeologist, and I'm talking about details of the area. it's very surprising what I'm saying. Archaeologists have been working on this, and they find that various branches have taken on a basic step, competing against each other, and some have become extinct. They have failed in the competition against their own species. So you get these variants, but the main survivors continued up to the present, and this has been the case right through. Now, first humans were left, that we have to best of our knowledge, was about 2 million years ago. We find stone tools made by humans outside Africa, both in Europe and in South Asia, dating from about 2 million years ago. The ancient ones are from India, Pakistan, and on the Siwari foothills, and they are dated to 2 million years ago. Now, those, they belong to the genus Homo, they should have known. Not Homo sapiens, Homo erectus, so that is like GPL. And there would have been, once the first wave of immigrants started, as is the case today, there would have been succeeded by other waves who would have competed with these, those who left Africa for survival. Now, this is a question as to why they left Africa in the first place. Chances are that their technology has developed to such an extent that they are able to venture out across deserts and so on to tackle these new environments. I'm almost certain that's what happened. They didn't have the technology to combat whatever opposition the other animal forms and the environment had to offer outside of Africa. But with the steadily evolving technology, which even if human evolution, the technology also evolved, they were able to succeed. And it is a sort of humans. It led to eventually the final result was anatomically modern humans. What are referred as the meshes given at us. Now the entire world today is considered anatomically modern. Whether you are an African or a Bushman or an Englishman or Chinese or whatever. We are anatomically modern humans. Now, earlier on, as I said, there have been other branches of humans who were in India and Europe who went extinct, such as Neanderthal man. Recently, they have found another human called Denisovian in Siberia and eastern China, which is a parallel line to Neanderthal man. Once again, it seems to have gone extinct. But new molecular biological studies, DNA studies, indicate that Neanderthal man himself, although as main line in that extent, still the genetic, the genes have survived in modern Europeans. Similarly, they are now working on survival traits of genetic material from these Denisovians for Neanderthal life. In the Asian population of today, such as Australians, Melanesians, and I think us. If you look for the insulin traits in us, I would get all surprises in that. I come to that area. Now, in terms of, enough of the background, the earliest evidence of humans in India, 2 million years, we had reached Madras, which was archaeological, by 1.6 million years ago. Now, if we had reached Athirampakam by 1.6, as Madras was considered, undoubtedly he would have been in Sri Lanka as well, Why? Because it's like from sea level, and it links India and Sri Lanka. Now this has come on this place for at least 80% of the last 1.5 million years. Sea level fluctuation is placed. Sea level would have been much lower than it is today. Given the land link between India and Sri Lanka during the last 1.5 million years, there was no barrier to stop animals, including humans, from moving in and out of what is today forest Sri Lanka, but they would have been part of India, some part of India. So one can assume that Sri Lanka had humans, at least as early as 1.6 million years ago, no trace from there. This evidence of human Sri Lanka come from certain gravels which have been excavated in placed in the north, northwest and southeast of Sri Lanka, which are overlaid by red sands, including red sands, which you get very dramatically displayed at Ilnamaru, Ilnamchi, Mangram in those areas, and also Kudramale. And also from Amarpur and most likely at Yala, approximately another site called Niyanakar Kanta, so it's like a leader. Of those gravels, we estimate when I was first investigating them in the late 60s, early 70s, I thought they were very, very old. After because they had a much higher sea level, level and density. Geomorphology. Those gravels would have been at the same level as sea level then. And if there were high, very high sea level gravel, it means that the sea level would have been much higher. If so, that though, from that you take the gravel. Since the time I was taught this for myself, and I'm not here, these views have been modified over the last 4 years, 6 years. And they find that those sea levels would not have been high, and we have now postulated underground geological pressures can push these levels up. So our initial estimates were wrong. And we now have resolved to new methods of dating, alternative methods of dating, bit of firm dating. Tentative dating on the southern gravels is one set near Bungal. Amara Bhagat to 130,000 years, another set 80,000 years, another one to 26,000 years. But you know, man was around at least 130,000 years, as the earliest date we have from Sri Lanka. The next set of dates come from caves. And probably date. I'm talking about dates because dates constitute the spine of archaeology. There is a fashion nowadays to ignore chronology, to ignore dates. You can't do that because there is no archaeology. Without chronology, there is nothing called archaeology. Otherwise, it's sociology. Now, this is something which is missed by modern archaeologists. That's the thing to keep track. There is no time perspective. And that is said. The wrong methodological approach. So we found good series of dates from cave sites which were investigated by my colleague, not there, not there, from 48,000 onwards. So very dangerous. And we have human skeletal remains from 48,000 years onwards. To 5,000 years ago from this cave. All in all, they are anatomically modern. The skeletal remains were analyzed by anthropologists in Cornell University in the States and University of Arizona, detailed analysis were done. At present, there is a younger generation of anthropologists working on material from these cave sites. At the end, Professor Stock is working on. Essentially, the of morphological analysis of whole material are gone. Now it's molecular biology. They are trying to get DNA out of this material. When the first scientific at Cornell, they tried for 3 years at the lab in New York and failed to extract the DNA again. And this seems to be the case also with the other tropical countries such as India, where the coastal farm tropics or the invader, the more difficult it is, get DNA, find DNA or DNA for the damage. But that's an ongoing project now. And with steady progress in DNA analysis, we hope in the next 25 years, not sooner, we get more vital information about how genetic makeup. Now, the thing is, the compound matter makes things in more complicated. There is a new field which has sprung up called epigenetics. We, up to now, to have a genetic change in population, it takes a long time, actually, very long time, thousands of years. Various factors. Now, according to the new discoveries, in genetics, those changes can occur from one person to another, from father to son. And this is brand new, it doesn't form part of the gene itself, it is something which which is added onto the gene. That's why it's the drug epigenetics. And that's new, and that's where really market matters in terms of transmitting digital genes. So that's where we are now. In terms of the gene of Siran, I just told you, from 100,000 onwards, we have archaeological deposits. The earliest human remains come from cave sites about 48,000 years ago, which is amongst the earliest in the whole of Asia. There's another set from the near cave in Borneo. And then there are our remains, so we have many ways to meet this country for our central remains, central remains. And they are so precious that people think that anybody can touch countries and examine them. I have numerous requests from universities and GPR who cannot be in genome of organized. There's nothing to it. This is more valuable than anything we have. You stay safe with our blood, sweat goes in there, and then you bring this sample for it. These are things which are being shut down. We should know and realize what a treasure we have on our hands. Now, what you need to consider now is from then on, from the Siran Deraniyagala on the population, about 6 million years on, humans have been coming here. Modern humans are set to the left Africa around 100,000 years ago. First record from Sri Lanka is from 45,000 years ago. First record from Asia is from 45,000 years ago. This remains to be found. Now, what happened on in the case of Sri Lanka and vis-a-vis India? As I said, human evolution is based on survival. They go for the ecological measures which offer sustainability, the most amount of food and water. What is it? To sustain. They would have fought for it. And the university and that other person pushed out. Who's out there? You are this hospital area. This is what would have happened. But if one would compare what people refer to in annual studies that as carrying capacity, the ability of a given area to sustain life, human life. We find that several parts of India are far superior to us. Why? Because the animal density is higher, fauna density is higher, one thing is superior. One thing which offsets that is lack of water. So you've got balance to do. Nobody has really undertaken such a study, but they've done it for animals, such as in the Lanka National Park. In central India, and where they have computed the density and the fauna density which can be sustained by the environment. I have the capability to for our country. And all in all, we find that Sri Lanka has not very attractive environment for human behavior, or for hunting and gathering. Without agriculture, there is no agriculture. So, it's a non-attractive area. What would have been a refuge area for people to be pushed out of better areas in India? They had come from India, they had come to India, and those who could compete against these people who moved into India were pushed into areas of less carrying capacity, and eventually they ended up in Sri Lanka. My score was that is. This would have contributed to no sea between the two countries. And certain areas such as the dry parts of India with water would have sustained a higher density of operating than us. Now, once wave of arrival settled down here, if anybody guesses when the next wave of the world will arrive from India, the sea repeats itself. One wave is pushed out here to this country, and then some other unfortunate block gets shoved out again, they land on top of their heads. And this would have been the case for the sea. So when people say that the Rajputas, the Adivasis, are the sole indigenous, their oldest inheritance of this country, it's true. What are the need of what the need of? Just if you fall to me, these themselves are made up of layers and layers and layers of genetic input of arrivals from India who were mixed with the locals. And they produce a or whatever the argument at the end of it. And this could be the case for tens of thousands of years. There was a famous person arrived in South America. So there is absolutely nothing called a true, pure Aboriginal. So that was enough answer. It's a real mix up. That's all. It's not even layer, it's not a layer cake, but it's a bit of a hardship. Mind you, on a recent plan for the born people, in prehistoric times, there is a fallacy that the Vedas are pure and that that's it. But that's wrong. It's common sense that you get layers and then, of course, individuals coming in. They mix. Now, so much so for prehistoric time. Archaeological work has demonstrated that these humans were dependent on stone tools up to about as primary artifact up to about 1000 years ago, 1000 BC, 3000 years ago. At this point, around 1000 years ago, perhaps somewhat earlier, 250. Iron technology makes an appearance in this country. So far, we have no evidence of all Bronze Age. Bronze Age, not unlike in Northwest India or Peninsula India. There is a rapid transition into iron technology. Now, that resulted in new cultural revolution. Subsistence revolution. This country, which was at the backwater as far as sustainability of humans was concerned, where the carrying capacity was low due to low animal density, low density of edible food, such as the ants, suddenly became at a high carrying capacity. Why? Because with iron technology, one could kill the ground for we should start agriculture in this country. Our soils were heavy and rich. We had enough water. There was some jump in agriculture. and it's more complicated than that. Professor Premchandra, who is here today, head of this institution, his pioneering research in the modern case has indicated that around 17,000 years ago, that certain plants, certain cereals were decarbonated. And that by 10,000 years ago, they were full cultivation. Process began around 17,000 years ago, in full cultivation 10,000 years ago, and that it peaked around 3,500 years ago, I think this is. So this means that the concept of agriculture was existing now, after we as a whole time. Now there are other centers of farming, such as the Belgium in the Middle East and in southern China, for example, equally old. And then, now we find this new center, work in this country, which shows that there was another stocking survey in the center. We don't know the effects of what that is. It's a new field of investigation. It's like another 20 or 30 years report. They have been able to decide permanently. This is exactly what happened. Very, very labor intensive. You need dozens and dozens of researchers working on pollen to proceed. It takes time intensive, labor intensive. It's only one person who's working on it now. So this is something which needs to be intensive. Right, so the idea of agriculture has been there, and certainly in there in India. With our technology, agriculture is cost undoubtedly. The concept of agriculture undoubtedly would do it. From India, the idea would have been built with us that cost agriculture is possible. Became technological possibility in time, and suddenly this country became an area of attraction. Not for relic tribes to be pushed out, but for the mass tribes to move in. And implemented it also and technology is what has happened. From 1000 BC onwards, they are finding people moving in. Anthropologically, not much has been done. Professor Kennedy from Cornell worked on some of the tables, and he found that they were different from the earlier historic instruments. So, in other words, postulating arrivals of India. That's the schedule of the company. You know, this set of a chain reaction, this became an area of attraction. People started buying in from India by fruits of it, displacing the original so called Aborigines or inhabitants of this country with their. Into technology, absorbing them, displacing them, both of them simultaneously. And modern Sri Lanka was born. Historical Sri Lanka was born, both historical Sri Lanka was born. Settled agriculture, settled villagers, settled towns, and what was the basis which had become easy. So we can use and we never suspected. And we were set to advance to urbanized culture. The procedures, the processes involved are still being worked out. As Professor Sengaratna here is working on that, that's the area. And this is a major research problem that has probably coming from the University of. And also holding on to the result of the settlement and so on. The whole untraveled area in this country is around here. Now, crucial is, here comes another form, as it were. We all assume that India in the way. And wanted to come out. And all that was done with the Emperor Asoka, and lo and behold, right can do. It's a huge technological leap. It's data storage, it's information technology, it's a leap for data storage. It's unbeatable. The storage for the future, data which there is not accessible, you could write it down. Yes, sir. So the rise of script is a period, it's an enormous step forward. And the seventh thing is there, and say that. But assume until very recently, then because if you have the rate of infrastructure, you do recommend an influx presumably from Iran. India adopted the script, its own script, Rakhmi script. And from there, it's ready to see that and so on. Our expression is now for 1988. What would I say about search on two different plates inscriptions on them? And when they were found, I checked the layers from the beginning and they seemed very early. I said, well, I had the layers really complicated and they came to between 500 and 600 before Christ. Two bits. Seven pieces of water from independent ones comes to important. Now this is a bit of a stir. That year, I was in the conference here where all the top figures in India were brought out. And when this was saved, they denied. They just said, maybe, but they couldn't deny because it's actually based. But they had a small publication that indicated that they got a reading was wrong, that they got the first layers mixed up also. So that was that. But I sent an extract of my paper for that 99 conference. Professor Mahadeva, who happened to be still is India's topmost figure. And he replied and said, how interesting. If this is true, you, Dr. Lanka, has revolutionized South Asia, South and South Asia. But until we find corroborative evidence from India, we can't accept it. So they are still open challenge. Next year, that was it. I was in India. On one of the Peshawar pictures, something like that, and there are some things where the picture is in the National Survey. And the speaker, a very senior person, Siran U is there. We have found it there, similarly, it was in the area from Shakshok. So, who is there? How nice that the two person is in right on the right track. Say, yes. That should be. Myself and the deputy inspector there, we got to see this thing. Low down, right? Next week. And there was a big pot there. And no sign of the senior after the assistant or something like that. So where is the inscription? She's seeing them. So there was this big jar. Where is it? It's in there now. The inscription was only inside. The main thing was that I never could see it was too dark. And you can also on the daytime. And that comes very difficult. They took them out of their leave. And I said, well, I don't want to have sex, but I won't say what was the name from my Indian colleagues. Anyhow, that was it just fizzled out. That was it. Then there was a complete blank. About 3 or 4 years ago, Professor Rao from the University of he wrote an article over explaining he had conducted on various sites, One was called Kodumanas, the other second was called Kodumanas. Especially Kodumanas, he has produced and conclusive evidence of writing on pottery in a burial ground, on a burial ground, aided by radiocarbon. Two, exactly the same basis our dates from Antarctica. Exactly the same dates. 500 BC. So, the Kutumana dates are not too similar, I'm seeing them. This one I'm pretty certain by solving it. So now it was time for me to write to Mr. Mahadevan and say, dear professor, it has happened now. You have found writing, pre-Asopan writing in your country. But miracle has happened. There was writing in there because of, unfortunately, it's in the south. which is different from your compartment, but anyhow, it's there now. On top of that, Sri Lanka, this one I want to give for this. Sri Lanka has found another set of writing in this country, Naya Amadura, from a region, also dated to the same period. So now, this raises a suspicion on the earth is writing doing it. Southern Prague, we have huge generic cities up north, like for some people. Enormous, I'm not going to just stick to it, but maybe it's about it. Why no writing in those cities? You know, this is the question. I mean, was it? Did it come as an inclusive idea from this land? And how was this scripture being written? So that whole, individual. And for all of us, looking at the process of organization in part of the world, this is of crucial importance. Finally, in terms of regional policy, I am keen in relations of whatever from inclusions from South India, increased storage stream, and then somehow, the record shows that by 6th century AD or whatever, the long distance market on a big scale between West Asia and China and so on. Before that level comes with Iran and so on in our days, depending on so Iranian bases, Sicilian bases from 2nd century AD onwards. Before that, we have taken water reform from India again from 300 BC. So, contacts and long distance contacts increased. And this project became a central attraction. In that, together with that, came new people, new populations, depending on us. Certainly, South Indians increased their relation towards us, and culminating in the two language or the 11th century. And then after the fall of Urundhundur, there was an entire business that broke down and there was a small kingdom that was over there. And there was a dry zone set up, Akuranda, but there was no central citadel. I mean, the chief power was created at first of that, there was a great cross of Malaya and the Oman. And the wet zone is not suitable for it. So the carrying has dropped. Level of cultural width dropped. The scale of that of mountains dropped. It is that saved the European invasions. Sorry, the Portuguese, followed by the Dutch. And then the English. Now all this, especially the English, all this is enormous cultural power in our country, which absorbed the punches of and it's in our makeup now, ulcer cultural makeup. And in various parts of the country. And in areas less so than in India. The I got finished with enormous. Yes, with English man. It's enormous. And it's not for the worst. I know the deals I did as something like that. The English were the people who are in this civilization. But like I say, you live in nowhere. You are stuck to. You are copy paste by the British and English by the.
Holiday.
dynamic image, and we try to do it in similar ways compared to in some countries.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deraniyagala.